of charity? Because a prayer would say we can't do anything.
Really good. Get that inside of me. We're like, God, my life depends on you. That's what prayer is all about. God, my life depends on you. God, my life depends on you. 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 That's what we do in prayer. It's like, God, it depends on you. Depends on you. Everything depends on you. This week we had a really a good theme that Mark Madison says pretty often. He says, pray like it depends on God, because it does. And everything in all of life, it depends on God. But work like it depends on you. So there's a reciprocal part of it, a prayer saying, God, I need you, I need you, I need you. God, it's you, it's you, it's you. God, to your glory, to your benefit. You know, over and over again in prayer, right? But then the second part of it is, okay, now the response. So a great testimony this morning is Sandy's response. Is saying, she's been praying, she's been praying, she's been praying. And then the Holy Spirit said, go talk to this lady. Right there in front of you. Wow, now it depends on you. Work like it depends on you. Now we have to do something in response to our prayers. Yeah. And so as we get excited about praying and telling God things, he's getting excited because he's like, all right, you guys are getting ready to do the thing that you guys are praying about. Love how God's economy works. His whole master plan is amazing. And it's humbling. Say, God, wow, you want me involved in this big picture of changing the whole world, this big picture of changing my life. God, you want me involved in working this thing out. That's so amazing. This morning we're going to be talking about prayer, and there's been a word thrown around, and I'm like, you know, sometimes when we use these words, and we're like, not sure about these words, I want to talk about revival. What does it mean? Lately we've been praying, God, send a revival. We've all started with thoughts. I want to look back to start with, not the only revival, but this is going to be about a time where God began to move, and it started in 1901. It's kind of the where our church, Cap City Church, kind of flows from this vein of people that said, you know what, I want to seek God. Actually started in a small Bible college. Did you guys know this? This movement, we call it Pentecostal movement. It started in Acts 2. We can read the Bible, right? But there was a renewal that happened that in 1901 in a Bible college, actually in Topeka, Kansas. You know, there's a whole bunch of Bible students that were getting together, and the leader of that Bible college name was Charles Parham. You guys can Google this; it's a cool story. But Charles Parham had actually went on a trip, and he gave some scriptures to his students, and he said, "While I'm gone, figure this out." Anybody like figuring things out? I love this opportunity to solve a problem. You know, so they're like, "All right, so this Acts 2 thing." Here it is. Here's the scripture. While I'm gone, you guys study. You guys think about it. What is it all about? And they began to search and pray. And they said, you know what? This is going to be instrumental for us completing the mission of God. Yeah. And so when Charles came back, there's a young woman. Her name was Agnes Osmond. And she had a big dream. During our prayer time, we've been challenging us to dream big. What are some God-sized dreams that he's given to you? What are some God-sized dreams that you have that you know if it weren't for God intervening, it wouldn't happen? Well, at this point, Agnes, she had a dream. She said, I want to be a Chinese missionary. I want to go to China, and I want to see people saved. I want to see them transformed by Jesus. I want them to receive the gospel and come to know him. And at this season, of course, hey, this is a close thing. This is almost an impossible dream. A little girl a young girl from Kansas, go all the way over to China. I mean, this is before it only took 12 hours to fly over. I mean, this is a hard thing, a big dream. But she said, you know what? I'm reading this book of Acts stuff, that I'm reading and seeing God do things, that I'm reading and seeing the Holy Spirit poured out on these people, and they begin to speak in other languages, and just like they spoke in other languages, just like the people that were outside of the building were speaking, they all knew the same language. They were speaking, and they were hearing God's praise in their own languages. It was this miraculous moment where the Holy Spirit was poured out upon them, and she said, you know what? If it happened like that in the book of Acts, it can happen for me.
Yeah.
And she asked the prayer, the team, the student that was with her in the small Bible college, and asked Charles. He said, all I can see, I see this pattern that when they laid hands on each other and they prayed, and all of a sudden the Holy Spirit came on them. And so she asked, she said, can you guys pray that the Holy Spirit would come upon me? I want to do this impossible thing. I want to go to China. I want to be a missionary. And I don't see any other way. I see this as the answer. Let's pray. Let's make it happen. Let's make it happen. She began to pray. And she began to, and the Holy Spirit came upon her. And for 3 days straight, she couldn't speak in English or write in English. All she could do was speak in Chinese and write in Chinese.
Praise the Lord.
This is documented. You guys can look it up on Google. You can see the newspaper articles. This is how all of a sudden it started. These Bible college students said, there's something more. There's something we're not experiencing. There's something in the Bible that I want. There's something in here that said, man, there's more. Let's study it. Let's figure it out. And they said, you know what? The answer is, we've got to ask God for it.
Right.
We've got to ask God for it. We gotta pray, we gotta believe, and when they begin to believe, and they pray, all of a sudden this young lady began to speak in tongues, and she began to speak in Chinese, and fluent Chinese, where 3 days before she could never speak in that before. Oh, our language. And it didn't just stop there. So now all of a sudden they're experiencing God, and people are what would be described today, someone would call a revival. People begin to come to know Christ, because all of a sudden God was doing it. They were experiencing God. They were dependent on God. They were saying, God, you're able. And then all of a sudden, things were happening. People were getting saved. Miracles were happening. People were speaking in tongues. And all of a sudden, this pattern began to grow and grow. And so Charles, college leader, said, you know, I'm going to go around. I'm going to start teaching about this. This is an experience for today. It's not just a Bible thing we used to read about. So we went around to college. And then there was a man named William Seymour. And he wasn't actually in the Bible college. He was just working in the Bible college. And he wasn't even allowed in the classroom. And you know what? He sat outside and said, I didn't want this. I need this. I want this. And he would sit outside the class just so he could hear and get some of that good stuff. He's like, I know it's there. I know that's God. I want something. And I want to talk about this a little bit later. And sometimes I use the word desperation, but I don't want us to be desperate. Usually desperate is something that there's a lack, right? There's desperate for it, I have a lack for it. I want us to be determined. And that's what I see when I look at William Seymour's life, and I look at the way he was determined to receive that. He wasn't going to let an obstacle stand in his way from receiving what God's truth was doing. He ends up going out to Los Angeles to get the invitation to go speak. God begins to move. They go to Bonnie Gray Street. There was a house on Bonnie Gray Street where they were preaching and people were getting saved. And there were so many people gathered. God was doing so many good things in people's life that the house patio actually collapsed because there were so many people.
Yeah.
And said, we've got to find another room. We've got to find another place. We've got to find, because God is doing stuff. People are coming and making their life right with God. They went to Azusa Street. This stuff is all recorded. This is all the Azusa Street. Old missionary Alliance Church that had been started to be used by the post office, and they started to have, they had a lumberjack yard there. They had a coffin. They were making coffins there at one point, and then it was a stable. And all of a sudden, they said they found it $8 a month rent. And they began to have service there. They began to meet with God. They began to call out to God. And people, you have stories of God moving. People walking down the street, blocks away, feeling the presence of God, and finding their way to the service. And they don't know why they're there, but they know God had brought them there.
Amen.
God moving. When we talk about revival, sometimes we say, God, revive us to something that passes. This week, Mark Madison, one of the devotional topics was, Lord, do it again.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
Do it again.
Yeah.
God, you did it once. Do it again.
We're there.
And that's the type of heart as a church we're praying for. When we talk about revival, or we can talk about a move of God, or I like to use the word an awakening. There's also, you can read in Google up great awakenings that have happened where cities transform and regions transform. So much so that bars and alcohol started closing down because God was moving and people's hearts were getting right with Him and they're being awakened to God's presence. So I love using the word awaken. I want this city to be awakened to who God is. I want us as a church, I want us as individuals to be awakened and say, God, you are who you say you are. You can do what you say you can do. Let's do it.
Yeah. Amen. Amen.
So when we talk about revival, we're talking about a move of God, a God-ordained time where people's hearts begin to turn towards God, where sin and the things that entrap us begin to be released from them, and we begin to walk into the fullness of what God has for us.
That's right.
That's what we're praying for. God, do it again. God, do that. Where my sole desire is wrapped up in all of who you are, and all of your heavenly, I just want you. And I'm determined to do whatever it takes to get you. Whatever you may ask of me, God, I want it. That's our heart cry. That's where we're going.
Yes.
I hope you know that. And if you didn't know, now this is an introduction to it. This, as the pastor and I and the leaders of the church, what we're believing for is this.
Yes.
If you didn't know that, now you do. We're heading towards a season and a time where we're saying, God, we want nothing less than all of you.
Amen. Amen.
That's
Amen.
What a season of revival, or that's what a season of awakening, that's what a season of a move of God, or whatever we want to, that's what is marked by, is a people that says, you know what, no matter what the cost, that's what we're going to talk about that a little. But no matter what the cost.
That's right. It'll require either, didn't it?
I want it.
That's right.
I'm sitting in a waiting room, and there's an annoying lady across the room, and no matter what the cost, no matter how it is for me, I'm going to do it.
Yeah.
I want to be obedient to you, God. God, I want to move it. I want to listen. Yeah. I want to be obedient to your move. Because, God, I want to pray like it depends on you to change this city, to change my heart, to change my neighbors, to change my loved ones, to bring their heart towards you and to renew them towards you. I want to pray because, God, I know it depends on you. Because, God, you are sovereign, and, God, you're in control. And nobody comes to the Father except He draws them. And no miracle happens by certain individuals' hand. It only happens because God says it to happen.
Yeah.
Right? And so we pray that way. God, it depends on you. It's you. It's you. It's God. It's you.
Yeah.
Right? But then the second part of it, it says, now I have to walk out in faith. I got to step out in faith. I got to do what the Lord is leading me to do, because He's moving and He's speaking and He's asking and He's leading, right? And then our response to it is, yes, Lord, I'll do it with you. Yes, Lord, I want it. And so when there's a beggar on the side of the road and he's asking for money, he says, I don't have any gold and silver, I don't have. But what I have to, I give to you, stand up and walk. I mean, those are the type of moments. It requires us to say something, to do, to work. Like it depends. There's freedom in our lives that we desire, and we can pray, God, take this desire away. God, do this. Break this in my life. And guess what? He sent Jesus. He sent the power, the same power that raised Christ from the dead is living in us. I mean, He's there for us, for the breakthrough. And then it depends on us to say, you know what? I'm going to do the work. I'm going to stop watching this thing. I'm going to stop being influenced by this. I want to be determined to change my way. It's going to be determined to do it.
Praise God.
Some of us get in a desperate place, and getting in a desperate place then increases our determination. But I don't want you guys to be different. I want you guys to be determined. I'm going to get what all that God has for us.
Amen.
Because He has far more.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Peter sitting in a jail cell, in shackles. An angel comes and slaps him by the head, walks him out of the jail. He thinks it's a vision. He thinks he's dreaming. What is the reality that God delivered him? That's when I start experiencing things like that. Matthew chapter 7, verse 7 and 8.